Well, good morning, everybody. Well, that sounded somewhat half-hearted. That's because I've made you move, isn't it? So let's try that again. Good morning. So I feel a bit like a visiting speaker this morning. This is the second time this year I've preached at Greenford Baptist Church. So the last time, you may remember, I was a last-minute substitute because the speaker that was due to speak at the church anniversary pulled out at the last minute. So I was asked to come and speak. This is my second time. So it's really good. In case some of you don't know me, I'm actually one of the pastors here. I'm Pastor David. I think I should be renamed Pastor at Large, seeing as I spend more time not here. And then maybe we could rename the other pastor the Large Pastor. What do you think? I know that's going to be picked up. There we go. Let me read to you. I'm going to pray in a moment, but let me read to you this very well-known document that I'm sure you have pored over many times. This is the leadership team strategic objectives for Greenford Baptist Church. How many people have read this? Well, that's three of you, four of you, five of you. That's not bad. So it's on the website. And I want to read to you the first section because it's very relevant to what I'm talking about this morning. So the first section is headed Mission. And there are 10 statements there. And here they are. Number one. So these are the strategic objectives of the leadership of the church here. And this is not just a piece of paper. At least one meeting in 2 months, the team review this and look at what progress is being made towards these objectives. And there are SMART goals that underline every one of these objectives to help the church move towards the things that we believe God's calling us to do. So here are these 10. Number one, to devise, maintain, and develop effective strategies for reclaiming ground and restoring hope with the good news of God's love and care for our community. Amen? To see people becoming members of the church through the conversion of non-Christians, the recommitment of Christians whose faith has lapsed, and Christians who move into the area. Amen? I think these are great, as you may notice. To see children and young people continually growing into the love and lifestyle of Jesus Christ. Amen. Yeah. Number four, to be God's voice in our community. Just checking. Number five, to be known for our welcome, care, and love of God. Amen. To actively engage with the processes and structures of our local community, local government, education, business, politics, and support agencies. Amen. To be a community that values, expresses, and models a wide-ranging cultural diversity as we follow Jesus Christ, our Lord. To model, demonstrate, and work for the reconciliation of all people. Amen. To campaign for and work with those needing justice locally, nationally, and internationally. Amen. And finally, to have an ongoing commitment to overseas mission by sending and supporting through a variety of resources. I'm a bit worried that that last one had such a pathetic amen, because that's one of the ones that I'm going to talk about this morning. Let's pray together. Father God, as we look at your word this morning and as we share together something of testimony of things that you've been doing in the life of the team that's just returned from Mozambique, I ask, Father God, that you're going to speak to us. We invite you to speak into our hearts and minds. Father God, we're here not because we want to gain more information, but we're here because we want to have an encounter with the living God. And we ask you to be at work in us and among us this morning, in Jesus' name. Amen. A few years ago, for 2 years running, we had a church motto that was taken from the book of Acts, chapter 1 and verse 8, which reads this: "You will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth." And that's where I want to start this morning. So if you'd like to turn with me to Acts chapter 1, We're going to look at the first 8 verses. Let's give some context to where this verse is drawn from. Acts chapter 1, and we're going to start at verse 1, and we're going down to verse 8 this morning. And as you will remember, hopefully, from times that I've spoken here in the past, I like to get everyone involved in teaching. So I've got some questions which I'm going to be asking as we go through, and I'd like you to be involved in answering those questions. I am going to be doing 2 interviews this morning, so a lot of my questions will be directed at Chris, who's here, and Regiane, who's here as well, who are with me in Mozambique. But before we get there, I've got some questions for you. Is that okay? You know we're going to do it anyway. It doesn't matter whether it's okay or not. That's it. In my former book, Theophilus, I wrote about all that Jesus began to do and to teach until the day he was taken up to heaven after giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles he had chosen. After his suffering, he showed himself to these men and gave them many convincing proofs that he was alive. He appeared to them over a period of 40 days and spoke about the kingdom of God. On one occasion, while he was eating with them, he gave them this command: "Do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father has promised, which you have heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit." The Gospel of Luke, as we call it, and the book of Acts, as we call it, are actually one book. They're in 2 volumes, but they are the same work. And notice in the introduction here, in that very first verse, something really, really significant. Have a look at that first verse. In my former book, that's Luke's gospel, I wrote about all that Jesus, can we say these next words together? All that Jesus began to do and to teach. That's really significant because it's not all that Jesus did. It's what he began to do. So the implication of that is that Jesus, his earthly ministry, that's what's recorded in Luke's gospel and the other gospels. But that was only the start of his ministry. Phase 1. His ministry continues right up to today. And it even has more impact today than when Jesus was here in person. Because when Jesus was here in person, he was in one place at one time. Yes, he was doing miracles. Yes, he was teaching. Yes, he was absolutely 100% obedient to God all the time. But today there are tens, scores of millions of Christians in our world, all over the world, in every single country. Even in countries that you think there can't be any Christians working there. So take a country like North Korea, for example. There are Christians at work in North Korea. Think about whatever you want to name as the most extreme Islamic state in our world, Islamic country. There are Christians at work there telling people about Jesus. Every place. So Jesus' ministry is continuing today all over the place. That's the first thing I want you to get hold of. Second, there's something else that's really striking here for me. These disciples had spent 3 years with Jesus. Now, what a privilege that was, hey? 3 years with Jesus. 24 hours a day, most days. Not every day. Some days he wandered off to talk to his father by himself and left them to get on with it. Some days they did all right. Some days they didn't do quite so well. But 3 years they'd been listening to him. They'd seen the miracles. They'd listened to the teaching. And here's the amazing thing that's here. He says, "Don't leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised." There is something missing before they can start to do what Jesus wants them to do. You would have thought that 3 years of teaching would have been enough, wouldn't you? You're like, pastors go off to Bible school for 3 years, good theological training. I'm all for that, by the way. I'm a tutor, as you know, at a college. So I'm all for academic learning. But I tell you what, it's not enough. It's not enough. You need that fullness of the Holy Spirit. Here it's talked about being baptized in the Holy Spirit. You need that if you're going to serve God. You need that for ministry. We're going to hear more about that when I interview Chris and Regiane a little bit later on. They needed that. They spent 3 years eyeballing what Jesus was doing. How much more do you think we need it? To be able to serve him and do what he calls us to do. So when they met together, verse 6, they said to him, Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel? Bit of an odd question. We'll explain that in a moment. He said to them, it's not for you to know the times or the dates the Father has set by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you. And you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. See, the disciples still hadn't quite got it. I mean, they'd spent 3 years with Jesus. Now, they had been somewhat traumatized because they hadn't expected Jesus to be crucified. And after he was crucified and all of that shock they had, they didn't expect him to be raised from the dead and now to be standing talking to them. So, you know, understand that life was a little bit disorientating for them, but they still hadn't got it. What they're asking here in verse 6 is, putting it in modern terms, Jesus, are you about to set up a new political state for the people of God? A new kingdom to be established. And by the way, Jesus, when you do that, us 11 that are left, we'd quite like to be government ministers, please. And we'd like a nice car. Excuse the anachronism here. We'd like a nice car. We'd like a nice government ministry. We'd like a nice expense allowance, please. And we'd like some power. So this power you're promising, that's going to come in awfully handy when we're running the new nation. That's what's going on in their heads. Not quite what Jesus had in mind. That was the expectation among the nationalists who were part of the people of God. That's what they were looking for. When Messiah comes, the kingdom of God will be established. Yes, that's correct. But what they were expecting was a political entity, a new nation, and that they were going to be running it. Get rid of those nasty Romans that have been occupying us for years, and we will be top dogs. We'll be running the place. And as we're in with Jesus, we'll have the nice jobs, please. Yeah. The power they are promised is different. It was to be Jesus' witnesses in Jerusalem, in Judea, and Samaria. Now, I believe that this mandate that was given here to the 11 is also given equally to us, the people of God, those that follow Jesus today, Jesus' disciples today, who include us. Not only us, there are others, millions of others as well, but us. So here's the questions, right? I've got several questions for you. You ready? If you agree, well, whether you agree with me or not, on the basis that this applies to us today, what does it mean for us? What does it mean for you, us as church, for you as an individual today, to be a witness in the power of the Holy Spirit in Jerusalem? Do we all need to get on an LL flight and pop over to the Middle East? What does it mean for us today to be witnesses in Jerusalem? Mary, I'm glad you're here. It's good to see you.
Thank you. Well, it's where we live and it's where they lived. So it's on your home territory.
Home territory. You're happy with that? So how many people have got people living next door to you? Could you just put your hand up? Got people living next door to you? Excellent. How many people have got more than 10 people living in the road they live in? Yeah, that's all qualified for that. Excellent. So that's Jerusalem for you. It's where you live. God's promise is he will give you power in the Holy Spirit to be witnesses where you are in Jerusalem. So where's Judea? Where's Judea? So Jerusalem, we're called to be witnesses, but also in Judea. Where's Judea? El Al Plain, off to the Middle East, or is there something else? Hannah.
Judea is our place of work, uni or primary school, and supermarkets.
Okay. Any other suggestions?
Your local community.
Yeah. Any others? Okay, so Judea is the area that's around us. It's not exactly where we live, but it's that surrounding area. So how many people spend a chunk of their day not in their house or in their road, but somewhere else? Okay. Whatever that place is, it's Judea for you. It's where God is also calling you to be a witness in the power of the Holy Spirit. Uni, work context, wherever it is that you are, to be a witness in the power of the Spirit. The next one's a bit more difficult, Samaria. Now, let me tell you a little bit of history for those that don't know. The Samaritans and the Jews didn't get on very well. It goes back a long time. It goes back to when the people of Israel returned from an exile and they came back. And there were some people there who lived in a town called Samaria, and they were excluded from being among the Jews. And they were still around. And the Jews disliked them so much, and they often had to make a journey, the Jews, from one side of Samaria to the other. And, you know, no buses or trains, cars in those days, it was on foot. And so it was, you know, relatively easy, short journey just to walk across Samaria, but they wouldn't do that. They hated the Samaritans so much, they didn't even want to get the dust on their feet that might have touched the dust of Samaritans' feet. So rather than walking across, they actually walked all the way round. I'm not making this up. Absolutely true. Jesus, of course, had a slightly different view. He went to Samaria, and you will know the story, of course, of the woman, the Samaritan woman at the well, and that whole story. So Samaria, for the Jews, was where their enemies lived. The people who they were excluded from society. They were people who were outside of the normal barriers of society. They were the people on the other side. In other country contexts, some people recognize the expression, they were the people over the hill. Or in another country context, they were the people the other side of the railroad. In your ethnic context, your own country, it might be a different expression. Do you know what I mean by those? Over the hill, other side of the railroad. So, for you lot here, us lot, where's Samaria? I'm ever so glad you're here, Hannah, because some of these other people, they're out of practice from answering questions.
I might be wrong. Samaria could be the prison. It could be hostels where we have people like drug addicts or people who are just being rehabs or something like that.
Okay. So this is a social context rather than a physical context. I mean, in those days, it was a land, as was Jerusalem and Judea, but we've actually seen it here in terms of a social. So these are the places like prisons, hostels where there are drug addicts and stuff like that. Are you putting your hand up? Or are you waving your fan? You're doing both. Excellent.
It's with disenfranchised people, you know, poor people, you know, the youth gathered on the corner because, you know, all the budgets have been cut, there's no youth provision, whatever, old people where that's been cut.
I thought of extremists in our society, racists in our society, then people that you really don't like.
I met an evangelist a little while ago. Be slightly careful with this story. I met an evangelist a while ago working in the UK who is working exclusively among Islamic extremists, most of which are sympathisers with one of the terrorist organisations whose names you would know. So he is a Baptist evangelist working exclusively in that context. I'd say that's going to Samaria. So that sort of thing, yeah? Anything else?
I was going to say what Carol said, but that would include people who are actively prevented from, you know, engaging fully in society because of, you know, their status, their colour, whatever, you know, whichever way you look at it, if they're not fully participating in society because we are afraid of them or we don't like them or whatever reason, then those are the people we should be talking to.
Okay, so these are the outsiders. John?
I rather fear it might be a bit simpler than that because I think largely speaking, we reach out to people who look like us, think like us, are in the same social strata as us. And so, in a sense, it's simply reaching out to people who take us out of our normal comfort areas where we wouldn't choose to go.
Great. Okay. One more. To the ends of the earth. Where do you think that might be? Any ideas?
Wherever God takes you.
Wherever God takes you. I mean, that's everything that's left over from Jerusalem, Judea, and Samaria. So that's all the rest. So do you get a picture here that God is calling his people in the power of the Spirit to be witnesses everywhere? Everywhere. Now, most of you will be aware that three of us have just returned from a mission ministry trip to Mozambique. The background to this is that one of our SMART goals as a leadership team is that we will send one or two teams each year from Greenford Baptist Church in overseas mission. Most of these teams have gone in recent years to places where we have long-term mission workers. So we send them to Bosnia-Herzegovina with Adam and Rachel, where they're working there on a 10-year placement. Or we send them to Cyprus to work with Martin and Heike in that context there. But for many, 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 many years, Greenford Baptist Church has supported an organisation that's now called BMS World Mission. When we started supporting it, it was called the Baptist Missionary Society. But it's now called BMS World Mission. It is the mission arm of the Baptists in the UK. And works overseas in a number of countries, somewhere between 30 and 40. I forget the exact number. And in conversation with them a little while ago, some of us from the leadership here were at a meeting with some people from BMS, and they suggested that we might like to send a team to Mozambique. It's 18 months ago. It was the very first church team sent to work with the BMS people working in Mozambique, and we were asked if we'd be willing to go. So we talked about it, we prayed about it, and we ended up going. So let's start about Mozambique with a little bit about Mozambique. Chris, come and help us here. Chris has put together a few slides. Some of these you will have seen last week. If you weren't here last week, of course, you won't have seen them. But there are some different, slightly different ones as well. Just give a little bit of a context of what's happening in Mozambique. Do you want to grab that other mic? Because at the end of this, we're going to need two mics, so we might as well have one each at the beginning. So off you go.
Okay. Bon dia, church.
Bonjour is just good morning, good day, it's greeting. So bonjour, it should be actually bonjour igreja, because you're mixing Portuguese and English. So bonjour igreja.
Bonjour igreja.
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 Igreja. That's
yeah, thank you.
Good morning, church. Actually, now, I'm sorry. Boa tarde, igreja. Yeah,
that's because you were going on so long. So, yes, we went off to Mozambique, which is a Portuguese-speaking place. I do not speak Portuguese.
As you may have noticed.
I've already reached my limit. So when I signed up to the trip, I wasn't really sure where it is. So I had to look it up on the map. I can't remember if I signed up before I knew where it was. I think I knew it was in Africa, but not exactly where it is. And it turns out it's a really long way away. So we flew about 6,000 miles just to get there. We had to go via South Africa, hang around for 4 hours, and then transfer on a tiny plane to Mozambique. I could touch the ceiling of the plane with my head. So it was, fortunately it had jet engines. We thought it might be propellers. So, you know, this was not good news for me. So, in case you haven't seen it on the map, Mozambique is there where the big arrow is. Mozambique became a Portuguese colony in 1505, so a long time ago. In 1964 to 75, there was a war of independence, and from 77 to 92 there was civil war in Mozambique, and in 2016 there's still stuff going on, as we discovered. So as Pastor David said, we went to Mozambique as a BMS insight team, basically to see what BMS are doing there. But in addition to that, we also wanted to contribute ourselves. So we focused on leadership training at First Baptist Church, the Kadesh Orphanage, and Manga Church. We were staying in the country's second largest city, Beira. Fiona was our BMS supervisor, on the left there. She drove us around, put together our program, our two-week program for us, which worked really well. So basically, she was responsible for us and logistics and that kind of thing. She's been training up Carlos. He was fantastic. He's actually visited GBC last April for our anniversary meal. So some of you may recognize him. Mozambique has many natural resources, but civil war has brought the country to its knees. We visited this building. It was constructed in 1954, and it's got an Olympic-sized swimming pool, and in its heyday, it was an amazing building. This is what it looks like today. It's a slum. It's home to 1,000 people. So quite in a graphic illustration of what civil war has done to the buildings, let alone the people. The Human Development Index measures life expectancy, education, and income. Mozambique is 180th out of 188 countries. So it was 178th, and now it's 180, so it's going backwards. A friend I met there, Felizarda, can remember going to the cinema as a child. But all of the cinemas in Beira closed down years ago, so you just don't have these opportunities to do these things anymore. And we also heard that the price of basic goods like bread has doubled in the last year. So it wasn't an issue for us, but the local people have to contend with that kind of thing going on. We visited Mozambique when it was at its absolute best, in my opinion. It's winter there now, but the temperatures were lovely, about 26 degrees. It looked like paradise. But in the summer, it gets hotter, and then it rains, and it's muddy. A lot of the roads are mud construction, so it can look like this. But fortunately, we didn't see any of that. So BMS, who we were going with, have some initiatives. So this one is called Loans for Life, where they invest in local people who are given training, and then they can set up businesses, basically. So this is one example. So one of the locals, Chico, was given a loan, and with the loan he bought 200 chicks. So he's been spending his time rearing chicks. And we were told that there was a queue at 5 a.m. last Saturday to buy his chicks for the national holiday period. So our supervisor, Fiona, has project management skills. That's what she did before she became a missionary 10 years ago. So she teaches local people how to run projects, basically. And it's really investing in the local people there. So it's building on what's already going on there. It's not just doing something and then going. But also teaching people how to be farmers, for example, because the land is very fertile, so it's ideal for growing crops. So it's about educating people. Okay, that's it for now.
Okay. Chris, I've got some questions for you. If I could just move you over to the side slightly. What do you do for a living, Chris?
I work for a lighting company. My job title is Field Applications Engineer. So, for example, I was away in Holland commissioning a lighting scheme. So, sort of computers.
That's this week you've been doing that?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. Yep. What's your role in the church here?
Well, I was asked this when I was in Mozambique by one of my friends there. And I said my role was to represent the congregation. So I don't normally sit over there. I don't have a theological degree. I'm not a pastor. But I feel that I represent the congregation of the church.
Okay, now Chris, this is your second mission trip in a year. This one cost you around £1,500 of your own money. Used up 2 weeks of your annual holiday. And I know that that's meant that you have not this year been able to have a holiday away with your family because of the cost and also because of using up the annual leave. Yeah. So why on earth did you go to Mozambique?
It was very important to me. The opportunity came up to go. When I was in Bosnia last November, it was a very positive time for me. It was mixed up with my baptism. I got baptized a couple of weeks before I went to Bosnia. And it was a life-changing experience for me. I found in Bosnia, with everything stripped away, like my phone, my laptop, my work and everything, I had a really direct connection with God. So that's what happened in Bosnia. And I found a similar thing happening in Mozambique.
So what did you do while you were there with us in Mozambique? What were the primary... other than we all shared some orientation and some learning about the context, but in terms we also went there to be able to do stuff as well. So what were the things that you did?
In the morning I was helping out at the orphanage Kadesh, which has about 30 boys aged from 7 up to 18. So they are given teaching in English, Portuguese, maths, and life skills.
And these were largely boys who were sleeping on the street before they were brought to the orphanage.
Yes, that's right. Yeah, street boys. We met one guy, Pastor Abel, who was one of the original street boys. So the orphanage has been going 23 years now. So some of the boys, the original boys, are in their 30s. So this is a man who was living on the streets, was taken in by the orphanage, Started attending a church where he found a mentor. The mentor suggested he went to Bible college, and now he's a pastor running a church. So it just shows how effective the work of the orphanage can be.
So in the mornings you were in the orphanage working with the team and the boys there. I know you did one or two other things there as well. In the afternoons, what did you do?
Well, I went there to have English conversation with people. So it's mainly the youth of the church. So they would come in the afternoon and we would just have chats, and we had some really good conversation, actually. Initially, people were a bit shy, but after a while, they soon got bolder, and yeah, we had some good conversations.
What most impressed you about the Christians you met there? Because we, you know, sometimes we have this image of missionary work that, you know, we've got everything, we've got all the knowledge, all the clever stuff, and we're going and we're just giving. But that actually is not the reality. So you met quite a few Christians, you got in conversation with people there, obviously in English. Mm-hmm. What impressed you most about the Christians that you met there?
Well, I think it's their spirituality. The place is very open to spiritual things. It's quite a contrast, in my opinion, to the UK. So people are very passionate about their faith. They work really hard. They study hard. Their knowledge of the Bible was really impressive. And it was a very humbling experience for me, because the people were so passionate, so dedicated. It was a real eye-opener, really. And I thought I was doing quite well myself. So I've been on two missions and so on. So yeah, I was feeling quite good. But then meeting all of these really impressive people was a humbling experience for me.
And part of the thing, I think part of my reflection with that, is that also because our lives here get so cluttered with stuff, a lot of the people that we met there actually are very poor. Very poor. I mean, some of those we had on the course that I was teaching on, you know, were very grateful to actually get a cooked meal, because that would not have been, normally they wouldn't have got a cooked meal in a day. Mm. So actually to come and be able to have that as part of the teaching course. You may remember we raised money as a church here to provide food in that conference. So finding these people who are so committed to God in that context, I was very struck by that as well.
Yeah, I mean, they don't have different sections to their life like we do. So we have like a social life, a work life and everything, a church life. But their whole life is kind of mixed in together. So they're spending time at church a lot of time. It's not just on a Sunday. They're there on a Saturday. They were there a couple of nights during the week as well. So they just hang out together as a unit. And we can learn a lot from them.
Which brings me to my last question for you. What are some of the key things that you learnt from your time in Mozambique?
How long have we got?
I want to talk to Regiane, so if you talk for too long, I'm going to stop you. So key things.
Yeah, there are so many things that I learned, really. We need to focus on the Bible. The Bible is the foundation. We really need to spend time studying it. I don't speak Portuguese, but I managed to communicate with people. There was a guy at Pastor David's training. He couldn't speak any English. I couldn't speak any Portuguese. But we were both having a laugh about this situation. There's so many things that I've learned. These people don't have much stuff, but they're so rich with their direct relationship that they have with God.
Another thing?
Let me get my notes. Okay, right. Yeah, when I was in Bosnia, I felt that God had prepared the way for me. And I felt exactly the same thing going to Mozambique. So, for example, I don't like traveling. We had this horrendous 6,000-mile trip to go on. But
this is the first long-haul flight you've ever been on.
It was a different level.
and I know that you were quite anxious about that.
I was. I was concerned about it. But our aeroplane was upgraded, our seats going out there, so we had bigger seats. because legroom was a concern of mine.
It never bothers me. When they say to me, would you like an upgrade? It's this much. I said, I can't reach the floor now. What do I want an upgrade for?
I thought I might be going there to sort of tell people that God is present in these poor countries, but that was so silly of me to think that, because it was so clear how God is working in these poor countries. Something else I wanted to say
is... This would be the final thing.
So. Okay. God uses willing people regardless of their skills. We were a very, the three of us on the team are very different to each other. Yet, just by being willing to be used, God could use us to do stuff there.
Great. Thank you, Chris. Here's Yanni. Come and join me. Good morning.
Good morning. Bom dia. No, boa tarde.
Boa tarde. So, Regiane, what do you do for a living?
Well, I have been a full-time student for 5 years, so I just left education. Actually, I've been working full-time for 6 weeks right now, since I left education.
So what do you, I mean, I know you were working also while you were in education, because you need to raise money to live. So what do you do?
I work as a healthcare assistant.
Okay. So, and what's your role at the church here?
Well, I haven't been around for the last 3 years, really, because I've been full-time in education during the weekend, working mainly at the weekends. But before that, I was really involved with Steve. Where is he? Daddy?
He's had to go. He's got a family event in Portsmouth, so he's on his way.
That's my father just running away from me. So I was involved in evangelism in church, so I was quite active on that. Sunday schools, doing everything that's without the church, anything, really.
Okay, so why did you go to Mozambique?
Well, I'm passionate about mission, and since I accepted Jesus long, 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 long time ago, I was just 12, so long ago. I always been involved back in Brazil in mission, and when I came to UK, I stopped to do everything, so I felt stuck because of that. A few years ago, I felt God calling me back to mission, so I've been on another mission trip with Steve. It was an evangelism trip to Cyprus. And I'm trying to fill up my gaps when I have time to do something about that. And last year, the new year, 2020, I made some notes about my life and things I wasn't happy with. I made quite a standard list of things that I would like God to be working in my life this year. And I was looking at the list when I was in Mozambique, and quite a lot of things on the list have already happened. And learning more about God and doing more to God, was something in my list, develop my God, the skill that God has given me. So yes, and Africa is a continent that is after my heart. So I have a lot of good friends from Africa and from other contexts as well. And I started to do some research about some short trips to Africa before I got involved in Mozambique trips. And then you called me at the beginning of the year about this trip, and I felt like that was God answering my prayers, and I straight away said, yes, I'm going with you.
Yeah, okay. Let's talk about some of what you did when you were there. Let's talk about Manga Church, first of all. Now, we were staying, Beira is... city, don't think of city in the way that you would perhaps think of city here. I mean, even in the centre of the city, people are living in houses that are made of tree branches woven together, filled with stones, with branches over the top. I mean, this is in the city centre. I mean, it's a very, very poor place. But Manga, we were staying in Manga, which is like an area on the outskirts of the city. And Manga was actually much poorer than the centre of Beira itself. And in Manga there is a church, it's a Baptist church called Manga Church. The pastor is ill, he's had a stroke, and so he's not been able to work for a while. And you went to Manga Church, and we had a first meeting with the leaders there, which was a little bit sticky at first, wasn't it, when we were having a conversation with them. But that changed a bit. So just talk about what you ended up doing at Manga Church. Now, before, had you ever preached anywhere before?
No.
So you never preached?
No.
Okay, because you ended up doing a lot of things at Manga Church that you had never, ever done before, didn't you?
Yes.
And I remember having some conversation with you before you went about this. And I remember you saying to me that you were trusting that God would enable you. Because yes. This was way outside of anything you'd ever done before. So tell us a little bit about Manga Church. We need to keep it, we've only got about 10 minutes left, and I've got one or two things I want to say as well. So
okay, we can stay a bit longer, don't we?
Because you could talk till 1 o'clock about Manga Church. We just need to keep it short.
That, So, yeah, Manga is a church in the suburb area, it's a very poor area. There's a church with about 150 members. Actually, we worked there in the church. I was expecting, like, okay, I'm going maybe to do a preaching one day or something like that. But actually, I took over the church for 2 weeks. So, yeah, and the church is quite busy. There's 2 days in the week they don't have service. It's Monday and Friday. No, Mondays and Wednesdays. Yeah, the other days is all packed of service, and they would like me to be teaching, preaching, doing whatever I felt God was saying me to do there. And yes, I said yes, and those two insane people didn't stop me, so
we were doing other things elsewhere.
We sat down the meeting and, you know, we trying to find out what they want us to do, because when he left UK, we didn't have a clue what exactly they were expecting us to do. So just Pastor Dave had a fair idea what he was doing. Yes, and I ended up involved in all the departments of the church. I ended up teaching adults, children, and young people, the youth. I done an amazing work with them. Something that touched my heart. After I came back, I kind of realized, yes, I think I done a good work with them.
So let's talk about the youth for a moment, because people here might know this. I mean, you're fluent in Portuguese, so you didn't need a translator. You were there, able to engage with people. And after your first meeting with the youth there, our supervisor was there watching, and she was somewhere between shocked and horrified at what happened in that meeting. Could you just talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, it's a long story.
You're going to make it a short story.
I'll try my best. Well, actually, there is a lot of problems going on, not only in Mozambique and everywhere around the world, but there are a lot of issues going on about morality, about how Christians live their lives there. It's very difficult for them to leave their old stuff. And yeah, I had made a quite decent study about our new identity in Christ. And I was developing it quite well. And then, so I'm kind of very practical person when I'm teaching. So I just don't say, oh, you should do this, but I kind of a way is for the person to do what I'm saying. And in this conversation, people start to speak up. So I didn't plan it. And a lot of sensible questions.
So this is questions about sex, questions about abortion.
Abortion, yeah.
All sorts of subjects that actually are taboo subjects normally.
Yes. What happened was people in Mozambique, they don't have this cultural issue of talking about their own minds and opening up and asking people those kind of things, especially the youth. And I went there, started to talk with them openly, and they just started to give me those questions. That's why, you know, Fiona got really scared because I started to answer them quite well, and I wasn't.
When she says quite well, she means quite directly.
Yes. So,
I mean,
yeah.
No beating about the bush. Now, here's the thing. So Fiona, when they came back, Fiona sort of took me on one side and just said to me that she was just a bit concerned. The next day, they went back, and some of the parents came and spoke to Fiona and to Regiane to say thank you so much that you had those conversations with our daughters yesterday. And Fiona was quite surprised by that, but really pleased. In fact, came back and said to me just how helpful that had been.
Yeah, because we went on a very... quite sensitive topic for the area, like sexual life in churches, how to deal with that, abortion, how to deal with hormones, everything. So, yeah, it was a quite open conversation. And, Fiona was frightened. I think she got red, blue, I have no idea what color, but she was, you know, close to me, and she was kind of making strange face, and I was quite, you know, comfortable to answer everything. And I had this conversation with Pastor Dave when he came back. I said, look, she's frightened, she's scared, but I'm not feeling like mm-hmm. that. I feel like that's what was saying me to do, and I've done it, and I'm quite pleased about that.
Okay. Our time has nearly gone, and I've got one or two things that I want to say yet. So what have you learnt about yourself in this time in Mozambique?
Gosh, it is a subject for a couple of hours.
Yeah, but we're going to keep it short again, Regiane. That's why I'm the team leader.
I can see the point here. Yeah, it has been really a journey of discovering, you know, about myself, about what God wants me to do. But I would, I have to summarize it. Two key things is, the first one is like, I cannot achieve my full potential in God on my own. I need leaders, and I really done a good job there because I had people to support me. Pastor Dave and Chris was there all the time with me, supporting. We, myself and Pastor Dave, we had kind of very helpful conversation, and what should I do? Is this the way right? So this or that. Yeah, the main lesson is that I cannot achieve my full potential in God on my own. I need mm-hmm. people behind me.
That's a really important thing. I want to say that again. Yeah. So you cannot reach your full potential. Here are you coming back from this context where God has used you in absolutely remarkable ways. And you are saying that one of the insights for you is that you cannot reach your full potential in God alone. You need other people to work with you.
Exactly. And the fact that I had been preaching there, that's one of those. So if you want to ask, send an email to Pastor Dave asking if I could preach, and I don't know if he was in sun, and he said yes. So
I didn't ask Regiane, just said yes, she's going to preach.
And then he sent me an email back, okay, if you want to ask me this, and they say yes, I'm just letting you know. And it was kind of okay. If he's saying there is two options here, or he's completely in sun, oh, I can preach, so it's better be read for both.
Okay. One other thing that you particularly learned about yourself while we were in Mozambique.
I have learned that I'm just a tool in God's hands. It's not mm-hmm. nothing about me. It's nothing about my skills. It's nothing about what I would like to do, whatever. And my last preaching there, it was like, you know, quite funny because I had prepared. I kind of, you know, it's come to a time after 2 weeks preaching every day, teaching, you kind of come, you know, it just, I got like, you know, starting to do things quite comfortably. And then the last day that I was preaching in Manga Church, I had prepared a decent study and looked at that, oh, I like it. It's something that I felt like really decent. But I know, a few minutes before I leave, this some verse in the Bible, some passage in the Bible came to my mind. Uh-oh, I might need it. And, you know, I'm quite good at the Bible. I know quite a lot about the Bible, but I have a weakness. I don't know where it is in the Bible. So I went to Pastor Dave. Pastor, please help me. Where is it in the Bible? So we ran, you know, a few minutes while I was waiting someone to pick up me. And, yeah, we find out where the verse in the Bible. And when on my way to Manga Church, was just a 10-minute journey, God started to like, you know, minister that verse in my mind. And when I got in the church, I started to teach. God said, no, it's not to what you prepare for. And yes, I done a teaching from a verse in the lastminute.com. You know, it's like, it's not about me. It's not about what I do. I think that's good. Because I done the study. For me, it was amazing. So, but it wasn't what God wants me to do there.
So this is about being witnesses in the power of the Holy
Spirit. Exactly.
It's not about what you can do. It's not about your ability. Same with Chris. It is about what the Holy Spirit is able to do in people and through people. So two very ordinary people who don't have a big ministry in the church here, who have, you know, they don't work for the church, but God calls these two people, takes them to a completely unfamiliar context in Mozambique, enables them through the power of the Holy Spirit to have a significant impact in loads of people's lives. So, Regiane, I'm going to stop you there because otherwise you'll talk all afternoon. Chris, can you just put the shirt video on the screen? Briefly, I want to talk about what I did, very briefly. I led a four-day conference for leaders from six churches, doing training in a variety of things to do with leadership. They gave me this on the final day. They decided they wanted to make a gift. So they took a, I didn't see them do this, but they went around and they collected some money. And they had enough money to buy me a shirt. So one of the ladies was sent off to go and have the shirt. You don't buy the shirt off the peg. You buy the material, then you pay the tailor to make the shirt. So she was gone for about 4 hours. Off she went and came back. I didn't know this at the time. And they did this, the final day, they did this thing to say thank you to me. So they sang, they stood in a semicircle around. And they, as you can see there, and the first one, a guy came and he came and put this shirt on me. And then they all danced up to me individually and came and thanked me. And that was really nice. And they said, when you wear this shirt, think of Bera. So I decided I'd wear this shirt today, as it helps me remember that. So if we get the video going, we will. It'll happen in the background. I was doing some preaching as well. I preached in the Primera Igreja, the first Baptist church in Bera. And preached there on both Sundays. And then one of the other main things that I did was every day we had a session in the evening, Chris, Regiane, and myself, for typically about an hour to an hour and a half of theological reflection on what God had been up to with us during the day. And that was a huge and significant time. Chris, in the first couple of days, was just overwhelmed with just the things he was seeing. Never been anywhere like this, never seen stuff like this. So just helping them to reflect on that through the Bible. So I was doing that. So our time has gone. Maybe if we can get that, we'll show it after I finished. Acts 1 verse 8. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you. And you'll be my witnesses in Jerusalem, all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. You do not need to go to Mozambique to be a witness to Jesus. You simply need to be where you are. Allow God's Spirit to fill you and work through you. If you're able to, please stand. Father God, I thank you for that promise that Jesus, your Son, made to us. That we will be your witnesses in the power of the Holy Spirit. Father, and I want to ask for every one of us here, that you will help us to be witnesses in Jerusalem, our Jerusalem, where we live. In Judea, that wider context that we go to, maybe where we work, where we have relationships of one sort or another, family and so on. In Samaria, where people who are outsiders to us are situated. And then for some of us, to the ends of the earth, to places that we wouldn't normally go, will you call us to. Father God, help us to be effective witnesses for you. In Jesus' name. Amen.
do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching videos at gbcweb.tv.